Hi. Stand on my hair. Right, so I've been over at Bill's house bead blasting the axle that we have for the 69 Fairlane wagon. But what we're doing this week is we're showing you how to identify and know what type of Ford 8 or 9 inch axle you have, or maybe buying at a swap meet. Now the other thing I want you to do is this. Do me a favor and pay attention to the episode, because there will be a Whataburger tent card somewhere within the confines of the show. And when you see it, email me at jford@autorestomod.com and let me know where it was by timestamp and a really funny good reason why you deserve a BF Goodrich t-shirt in your size. So look for the tent card. It's coming at you.
Brought to you by Eaton Detroit Spring, proudly made in the USA. Also brought to you by BF Goodrich Tires, who asks, are you driver enough?
Jeff and Cam share the love on Ford rear axles, both 8 and 9. Check it.
National Parts Depot has an update for your 1970 to 72 Chevelle. After 40 plus years, your Chevelle's wiring is probably a bit tatty and worn. Why not update with an American Auto Wire Classic Update Kit? It's about time you got wired. Check out National Parts Depot for Mustang and Cougar, Camaro and Firebird, Chevelle and GTO, Ford truck and Bronco, Chevy truck, Mopar, and Thunderbird. At our four locations, we stock the largest selection of classic car parts anywhere. Visit us at nationalpartsdepot.com or call us at 888-893-FAST.
You know, you're actually supposed to be cleaning it, not cutting it to pieces.
That's actually, that is actually grease off of when that pinion bearing was slinging. And in order to get down to what we want to do with the, trying to find some of the archaeological stuff on here, we actually have to make a dig.
And you got to dig through the eons of dirt and oil.
Yeah,
and
there's plenty of it on here. A lot of times these axles will have tags on them made out of paper. Typically down on one side or the other of the axle tube, there'll be a piece of paper wrapped around it so that they would know which axle housing went with which center section. Now those tags a lot of times will go away. Oddly enough, my 72 Mach 1 I had still had the paper tag on the axle.
There's some sweet rust.
Lots of sweet rust. Sometimes the actual center section or hogshead will have a lot of markings on it
too. For torques and everything.
Torques, sometimes there's just random marks on there that they knew what they meant. I got no idea. Why don't you get the Falcon ready to go, because we want to talk to him about some of the stuff on that.
Push the dirt.
All right, I've taken the sway bar off of this thing so I can basically get at the tubes and everything to check for marks on the axle. And one of the places you're most likely going to find marks on this axle are actually on the backside of the housing itself. Ford guys would put a ton of stuff back here sometimes. Sometimes nothing at all, but most of the time you'll find marks back there. All right, well, Cam, bring in the plastic.
Yay.
We'll put the body in there afterwards.
Oh, what?
Never mind. Did I say that out loud? I'm sorry. I'm going to put this down, and I got a product here that we got from National Parts Depot called Rust Blast from KBS. This product is something that we like to use when we're going in and trying to find these kind of things. Because a lot of times what rust will actually do is it will pop up out of a single hole and spread. So you'll have something that looks like you've got a lot of rust out on the back of the housing or whatever, and it's actually one little spot where the rust is pulled up out of the metal. So what I'm going to do is I've got a bottle that came with it. I'm going to spray the back of the housing a little bit here. And I think we've already got something showing up. Up toward the top. So right here, I don't want to get too wild with this. Actually, it looks like we have two marks coming up. This may possibly say oil. And what that is the guy that was working on this axle on the line wanted to let everybody know he had put the oil inside of the axle housing. So he marked the back of the housing with the word oil. It looks like we got a 97 in a Markall paint stick. Now, this is a Markall paint stick. Ford typically used yellow or white on their axles when they were doing stuff, and they would just write information on the back of these housings. I've even talked to a couple of guys that were UAW workers back in the day, and they said sometimes down the line, they would actually tell the guy down the way from them that they were going to lunch. Did he want to go to lunch? And they would mark stuff on the cars, believe it or not. Whether that's true or not, I don't know. In any case, you'll be using some of this on here as well. And there's also a lot of other colors that can end up on here. This oil mark is done in white. We're going to see if we can find anything else by looking at some of the other typical spots on this axle for paint markings. Now, some of these axles, you'll find that there are paint marks down here to mark where the tube goes into the axle housing. Now, this one may or may not have had something on it at one point, but it looks to me like the axle has just gotten too rusty and you're not seeing anything. My 72 Mach 1, there was actually a mark on the axle here. All right, so we don't have any marks there. Now, what I'm going to do next is I'm going to flip this axle housing up so that the differential or the hogshead center is facing up, because sometimes there are also marks all over the front side of this as well. You can see that Ford pretty much always painted the center sections on these red iron oxide. And you can find paint down at the home improvement centers that mimics this color pretty well. And that's probably what I would end up doing, is just going in and putting that on here to make it look like a factory set. A lot of times there'll be marks around this here, but you know, we could go on for days and days doing this, and it's basically like an archaeological dig. You just have to kind of start going through and generally cleaning around here looking for your marks.
Because this is an awful lot of work to put some paint marks back on an old axle.
Especially when going inside of a 1969 Fairlane that is not going to have a detailed undercarriage. The only thing I really wanted to show you with this was that there are marks on these axles. If you're building a concourse car, do it like an archaeological dig, trying to dig all the dirt and schmutz off the surfaces. You may find marks that you can use to put this thing back together and make it look really nice underneath the car, as long as you're doing an undercarriage that's a detailed undercarriage. Otherwise, not a lot of point. All right, axle housings. Now, most every vintage Ford you're going to run into, everything up through about 1974-ish, maybe a little later, you're either going to have an 8-inch housing or you're going to have a 9-inch housing. The easiest way to tell these two apart is the housing case on the back of an 8-inch is rounded. There is nothing indented on it, except you have two dimples on either side of the case here and here. The 9-inch is different than that after 1960, probably 61. In 1957 to 60, the 9-inch housing is actually completely rounded. So it's going to be really hard to tell whether you have a 9-inch or an 8-inch from that point of view on those early 1957 and 1960 housings. After that, the housings were set up just like this one here, where you have a raised center section with two flat spots on either side of the housing. The other thing that you have that are differences in the housings on an early 9-inch housing, like the one we have down here, you have the neck down housing. You'll notice that the housing actually goes into a smaller shape when it goes out to the actual flanges. The later ones, like our 1968-69 Fairlane one here, the housing actually just stays the same diameter all the way out. Those are the two biggest ways that you can tell whether you have an 8-inch or a 9-inch housing on your car.
All right, I'm going to talk to you about the center carrier. Some people call it hogshead, third member. I call it center chunk. It's actually called the Hotchkiss type.
Some people call them pig's heads, too.
Yeah, well.
Oh, wait, no, that's you.
They don't have anything that goes along with a donkey, so I guess you're free of that one.
The jackass.
Yes.
They also call them differential.
Yeah, they call them a bunch of different names.
There's a lot of different names. I'm going to have a hard time when I'm doing the SEO on this, knowing all the different names that I have to put it under so we can get people to watch the episode.
Tags
all over the place. Sorry. I'll let you get back to your work now.
Oh, really? Thank you. The easiest way I have found to determine whether you have an 8 or a 9-inch center section is to take a socket and try and put it on the two bottom studs directly beneath the pinion. If you cannot put the socket on, you have a 9-inch. If you can put the socket on the two studs, you have an 8-inch. Why that is, design.
But I like the 9-inch.
All right, now what I'm going to do is I'm going to talk to you about some of the things you need to know about center chunks for these classic cars when you're buying an 8-inch axle at this point. We're going to go over the 9 in just a second. So now, what I've got here is my 8-inch axle from the 69 Fairlane wagon, and this is probably the best 8-inch that you're going to run for a classic Ford because it is the right ribbing on the outside of the case. Now, our 64 Falcon has its original axle in there in the center point, and when you look at it, it only has the horizontal ribs in there, not the vertical ribs. These vertical ribs add a lot of stiffening to the 8-inch rear axle. One of the other things we run across with this too is guys are asking questions about how much horsepower can you get out of an 8-inch. And in talking to a couple of the bigger manufacturers, we talked to the guys at Curry and we talked to the guys at Randy's Ring and Pinion and came away with two completely different answers. The guys at Curry said only about 300 horsepower on an 8-inch. The guys at Randy said a little bit over 400, maybe even 500 horsepower. But neither one of them, and I won't even go this far, will say if that's rear wheel horsepower or actual at the flywheel horsepower, because you do lose some horsepower going through from the transmission to the rear axle. What I will say is this, if you're taking a Ford 8-inch and you're doing line launches with drag radials on it, you're going to probably bust it if you're over about 400 horsepower. Now, if you're doing this for the street, what we were told by the guys at Randy's is probably if you put a good set of bearings in here, even with a 355 traction lock, and you're doing a set of street tires like we're planning on running, like the BFG TA radials, the standard radials, not a real sticky tire, that 355 will live for a long, long time. Our Cleveland is probably only putting out about 350 horse at the flywheel. So with that being the case, we're not going to be running into a whole lot of problems with it blowing up, even though we do like to do an occasional burnout because we're guys and guys like burnouts. So those are the things that you need to keep in your mind when you're working with a Ford 8-inch axle. Now, can you build a Ford 8-inch? Absolutely. You can go in and do all kind of crazy stuff to make an 8-inch last. They even offer 31 spline axles for these 8-inch setups, but when you do it, you're going to be spending about the same amount of money as you do on a 9-inch, and there's only a very small amount of axle ratios available for the 8-inch center section. So you need to keep that in your mind when you're working on one of these as well. That's something to look at. If you want to get really specific in your axle ratios, you're going to have to probably go toward a 9-inch. There's also the thing of parasitic horsepower loss and weight. The 8-inch axle weighs less than a 9-inch. The parasitic horsepower loss, again, you're probably looking at about a 3-4% difference in horsepower loss. In my opinion, really not worth it. So you really need to start weighing what you want to do with the car. That's the most important part of this. If the 8-inch will work, and you talk to people like Randy's Ring and Pinion, when we chatted with them, told them what we were doing with our wagon, they said this 8-inch axle will work just fine. So we've talked a little bit about the 8-inch. Now let's talk a little bit about the 9. All right, so now I'm going to talk to you a little bit about the Ford 9-inch center section. Basically, this is the lowest kind of case you can run on a 9-inch. Your horsepower rating is going to still be pretty good on this, but what you're really looking for is the multi-rib design with an end right here in the center mark, like the one I'm showing you in the video now. The end case is the absolute best thing you can run for a Ford in a 9-inch. A Daytona pinion support for that as well, and you're going to be well over 500 horsepower for your capabilities. The things are rock solid. Every part that you could conceivably want for a Ford 9-inch is available over the counter somewhere in America. You can get anything from 28 to 31 spline axles. You can even buy custom hogsheads. The center sections are available in all kind of different configurations for racing. This axle is probably the most popular axle in aftermarket motorsports of any bar none. You don't hear about guys in NASCAR running a GM 10 or 12 bolt for a reason, because this thing is just way better. Parasitic horsepower loss on this is a little bit higher than the Ford 8-inch, but whenever you're going for maximum horsepower, when you're talking about 2-4% difference, so I'm not going to worry about that much, because let's face it, if you're having to redo the rear axle every time you launch the car because you're blowing the crap out of the 8-inch, you really kind of want to stick with the 9. So this one right here, as I said before, is not the top case. It's a little bit lesser case, but for what we're going to be doing with the car that this is going in, this will be just fine. The other thing I like about the forward axles on this, before we kind of get away from where we're at right now, is I like the ease of change out. If I had this thing and wanted to change the center section out on it, it's literally probably a 2-hour job. Not that hard to do, doesn't take that long to perform. An easy axle to do any kind of work on. All right, now what Cam's going to talk to you about now is how to figure out whether you have an open or posi differential on your car when the axle is still in the car.
All right, I'm going to show you how to find out if you have an equal lock or a traction lock rear end. This is Ford factory only. Now, we have the car jacked up, supported on the frame. Both tires are off the ground. What I'm going to do is grab the drive shaft here, start spinning it, and as you can see, we only have one tire spinning, which means it is an open differential. All right, now if both tires spun, you could either have one going counterclockwise and one going clockwise. Now that would also mean that you have an open differential. Now if both tires are spinning in the same direction, that means that you have an equal lock or a traction lock installed, which is kind of nice because then no longer one tire fire. All right, all
right. Right, now I'm gonna talk to you a little bit about axles. Basically, the 8-inch Ford axle from the factory was only available with 28 spline axles. Now in the aftermarket these days, you can get a 31 spline axle and a 31 spline differential for it to help increase its horsepower handling. The case is still a problem because it uses a very small pinion bearing. You're not going to be able to get away from that. And in fact, some of the 9-inches even have a small pinion bearing, but not as small as the 8-inch. The 9-inch, when it came from the factory, was available with a 28 spline axle, but the 28 spline axle had a larger pinion bearing on the pinion itself, which gives you a little bit more standing for power. It was also available with 31 splines from the factory, so you can find a factory axle with 31 splines. Now, the way to tell the difference on these is the end of the axle. Our 28 spline 8-inch axle over here has got a D shape on the ends of it, and that's the indication that you have a 28 spline axle, and that's going to be across the board. That's 8-inch or 9-inch rear axle. I don't have a set of 31 spline axles here, so the picture I'm showing you is a 31 spline axle end cap. When you see the three dimples on there, you know that you have a 31 spline axle. Aftermarket has 35 spline available, but again, you're going to have to make sure that your differential and your axle's made up to run those 35 spline axles. So, I'm going to send you over to our friend Cam.
I'm going to show you how to count the ring and pinion gear to determine your axle ratio. Now, I've cleaned a spot off on both my ring and my pinion gear. I've got myself a Sharpie. Going to make sure that I make a very easy mark to see. Mark the ring and the pinion. Now you have the thrill of counting every tooth on the ring and the pinion gear. Now you want to do these separately, then you divide them to find your axle ratio. Now, on with kindergarten. 1, 2, 3, 4, 31, 32, 33, 34. Alright, so our ring gear has 34 teeth on it. So I'm going to write that down. Alright, now that we've counted the ring gear, I'm going to count the pinion gear. We've got tooth marked there. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 10 tooth. So apparently I failed kindergarten because that is a 35 tooth ring gear. 35 teeth on the ring gear divided by 10 teeth on the pinion gives us a 350 gear set. Elementary school, I miss you.
All right, real quick, I'm going to talk to you a little bit about traction lock and non-traction lock axles. If you have an open axle and you're looking at these at a swap meet or whatever to buy, real simple way to figure out whether it's got a traction lock in it, and that's this. If you look at the back side of the case like we have here on the stands, if the bolts are all exposed all the way around on a Ford 8 or 9 inch, then it is an open differential. If, however, the bolts on here are recessed inside of this big humped raised area, this is a Ford traction lock unit. It's really that simple. Now, there are other types of units that you can have in here. You can have an Auburn. You can have an Eaton Detroit locker, which is going to look a little different. There's also the Detroit No Spin, but the two majors that you're looking for when you're looking for axles at the car shows or at the swap meets are probably going to be your open and your traction lock. And that's the quickest way to tell the two that you have. Now, there is one other way that you can tell whether you have a traction lock or not. Now, the splining inside of the axle of an open differential inside of here is actually solid all the way through. On the traction lock type, you don't have that. You actually have a split running down the middle of the splining inside of the axle housing itself. So one other way to possibly tell if you've got a traction lock or if you've got a open differential.
All right, now I'm going to show you how to determine your axle ratio if you have the axle sitting here and the center trunk is still in. Now, this is not a 100% accurate method. Now, I've put a piece of tape on the pinion, and I've put a piece of tape on the wheel end. Now, you're going to want to rotate the pinion until the wheel end goes a full 360 degrees. Be mindful of how many times you turned the pinion. So that's one turn. Two turns. And three turns. So that is a 300 gear set. Now, again, this is not the most specific way to determine your ratio. The best way is to count the gears, but this will get you in the ballpark. I'm tired of working on your stuff. My hands are dirty, my fingers hurt.
That was probably the funniest thing I've seen all week.
Yeah.
That pinches, doesn't it?
Yeah, it does.
I think I'll move. It's an 8-inch, but it's still got plenty of chutzpah.
Yeah, it's still got a little bit of inertia
behind
it.
It's got a fight.
Yeah.
It's got fight in it still. Well, I mean, I hope that that gives guys a little bit of an idea of about the 8 and 9-inch axles, because I thought it was pretty important to do that. The detailing side of things, to me, for most of our viewers, is probably a lot less important than the actual ratios and stuff.
Yeah.
Obviously, the detailing is just going to be cleaning and finding the marks.
I know it's a lot less important to me.
I know you don't care about it at all, but I do. I mean, I think it'll be cool. Once you see it all done, it'll look really nice to you. I mean, you'll think it's really pretty looking for an industrial piece. It'll look good. And what we're going to be doing next week is we're going to be coming back to you with probably, hopefully, the reassembly of this. We're still working out the details on the center section on the car. We'll be getting our springs from Eaton Detroit, shocks from Viking, through National Parts Depot, and the rest of it I'm not going to talk about because
we don't know. That happens a lot.
We're last minute kind of guys. Well, anyway, folks, that's our show for this week. So come back and watch us next time on Auto Restomod. Have a great week.
Speaking of last minute.
Oh, you know what you need to do?
I don't need to do anything.
You need to take this thing and steam clean it.
Anyway.
Guys?